Welcome to the Danvers Conservation Commission meeting for September the 8th, 2022. We operate under the Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40, the Wetlands Protection Act, and Chapter 26 of the Town of Danvers General Bylaw, the Wetlands Protection Bylaw. The way our meeting goes is after each applicant presents his or her request and the board has had time to ask questions and discuss the project, we will accept questions from the audience. Because this is a public meeting, it is required by law that you give your name and address before you speak. Although we may disagree on the issues raised, all persons present during this meeting are expected to be civil and to all other meeting attendees. This includes the members of the commission, staff, abutters, concerned citizens, and property owners and project applicants. We also request that you confine your questions to the project and only as it pertains to the Wetlands Act. We cannot handle, nor do we have jurisdiction over other items such as noise or traffic. All problems not related to the Wetlands Protection Act and the Town of Danvers Wetlands Protection Bylaw must be taken up with other boards. Moving on, we'll have a roll call of the members. Peter Wilson is present. Vanessa Curran.
She's her initials are there.
She's probably muted, but I saw her blank, so we'll say she's here.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Now we can.
Chelsea King.
Here.
Ann McGill.
Here.
And Michael Splain.
Yeah.
Okay. Next up is, I'm sorry, the first item on our agenda is an abbreviated notice of resource area delineation, and that's at 154 Water Street, DEP file number 14-1388. The applicant is Wind Development. The applicant has requested that we continue the hearing until our September 22nd meeting. So someone can make a motion. We will continue until then.
I'll make a motion to continue the hearing for 154 Water Street, DEP file number 14-1388.
Until our
next meeting on
9/22.
On 9/22, yeah.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Next up is a notice of intent for 24 Princeton Street. You do have a DEP file number. DEP file number is 14-1392. The applicants are John and Jane McKirk. And Bill Manuel is here to represent them. So, Bill, the floor is yours.
Good evening. So, Bill Manuel from Wetlands and Land Management in Danvers. And the McGurks are proposing to add on an addition to their home and then a detached barn out in the backyard. This is at 24 Princeton Street. The McGurks would be here tonight, except they traveled out to Buffalo to be with their daughter-in-law and son who had a recent child. So they will not be here tonight. This is a home, as I call it, in the Woodvale section of Danvers, most known for basically the streams have been historically rerouted to the rear yards and side yards of all the homes. And they've been historically trenched and even recently had excavators in the streams cleaning them out at various places in the neighborhood. So. Here we are, Princeton Street up front. The existing house is here. The brook, this is Frostfish Brook. And this is actually shown as an intermittent stream on the USGS map, but the regulations will direct the practitioner that if it's shown as intermittent, you need to evaluate the stream with the StreamStat program. In doing so, I found, or at least the program calculated, the watershed was greater than a half square mile, and the residual flow in the 99th percentile was greater than a 100th of a cubic foot per second. So with those two positive parameters, the regulations direct that this should be presumed to be a perennial stream. So we have accordingly shown the riverfront line going through the property here. Very easy to delineate because you could see from the topography that the stream is well entrenched and it just slopes straight down to the banks of the stream. So I have seven flags across the rear of the property, which denote bank resource area. There is no bordering vegetated wetland because it slopes so steeply down towards the water course. So we have the 35-foot no disturb line right through there and the 50-foot no build line right through there. Here's our 100-foot buffer zone line from the bank flags. This is the inner 100-foot zone of the riverfront, and the 200-foot riverfront line is here. So there's two major components to the project. One is to create a dwelling addition and take this existing patio and push that out to the outside of the new addition. It's a single-story home. This will be a single-story addition. It's 16 by 51, and the patio will be a pervious paver patio, and that is 14 by 51. It'll add a living room, a bedroom, and a sort of a den off the rear of the home. And as I said, it's a modest-sized home right now. The addition is not extravagant. It's a single story. It pushes out into areas that are maintained as lawn. This site is maintained as lawn from the street. All the way back, there's a wire fence along the end of the rear yard there, and then right at the wire fence is where the ground drops off. It's grass from the fence right up to the street. So this addition happens to be in riverfront area. It's outside of the buffer zone to the brook. It is compliant with the riverfront area impact thresholds between this gravel driveway that we'll talk about and this addition. There's a total of 4,216 square feet of riverfront area, and we're allotted a total of 5,000 square feet of riverfront area before we are deemed to have an adverse impact on riverfront. And as I said, all of that is pushed out into areas that were, well, mostly you can see where the existing patio is now. The addition is largely over that patio, and then we'll have a pervious patio on the outboard side of that. Now, John is a handy kind of guy. He's a carpenter by trade, a veteran and a carpenter by trade, and he's got a lot of stuff in the yard. And one of the purposes of this proposed barn will be to be able to store his camper and consolidate a lot of the stuff that's in five different sheds. So there are building supplies or building tools, building supplies, landscaping tools, lawn mowers, etc., that are all 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They're all in one of those five sheds. The location here, you can see there's a nice, beautiful, large oak tree right here, and there's another 18-inch oak. I think it's an oak right in there. There's another big tree here. There's beautiful trees that provide shade in the rear yard. And we're trying to position this barn so that we preserve those trees. That's why this barn ended up here. And there's a gravel driveway that will lead across, down along the fence and then into the barn. It does encroach into the 35-foot zone by a small amount. We're actually taking out this shed from the no disturb zone. I think there's a net impact of 220 square feet in the no disturb zone. And I think there's something like a net impact of just over 800 square feet in the no build zone. Now, obviously, we could have put that here. We could have moved it out of the no build zone. If you could take that rectangle and put it over here, get it outside the tree canopy of this large oak, as we've done here, keep it away from this tree canopy, which denotes where the root zone is, you would end up having this barn right here about 30 feet away from your patio and your brand new addition. We didn't like that idea. It won't look good, and it'll jam up the backyard unnecessarily. And I think I'd like the commission to come out and take a look at it, because you'll get an idea of these mature trees, and you'll get an idea of the openness of the yard, and you'll see that really one location here is really, whether it was here or here, it's the same impact. It's all grass. And so we are asking for a waiver to place that structure there, because basically it has no different impact than the, other than an adverse impact on the rear yard and the aesthetics of the entire property. To offset that, we have proposed a large amount of mitigation to improve what is basically grass here. We're proposing a shrub buffer to build off of the existing wooded area in the rear yard. And we've gone through an alternatives analysis in my my narrative, a lengthy alternatives analysis. I've provided you the breakdown of the impacts to your no disturb and your no build zones and the riverfront area as well. And I think you'll see that this is probably the best place for this structure. Now, Georgia has alerted me that I missed one little caveat in computing the impacts to the no disturb zone. I've reviewed that part of the regulations, and she is correct. I do need to tweak the location of this barn ever so slightly. I need to pick up about 40 square feet so that I am compliant with the upper limit thresholds established in your bylaw. So I thought I would come to the meeting tonight, hear your comments, hopefully have you come out to the property, and then we could incorporate everything into one plan revision.
Okay. One quick question on shed A that's going to be removed and replaced.
Yep.
Do you need to get relief from the ZBA for that?
We will look at that. There's already one there, and perhaps we do. Perhaps that needs to get pushed in somehow.
Okay, because in my mind, that's important.
I'm sorry, okay, in your mind, I didn't catch that, Peter. In your mind?
I said in my mind, that's important.
Okay.
If they're going to give you relief in there, they might be able to give you relief for the barn. Okay, I'll just leave that, whatever questions I have beyond that, till the end. So, Mike, let me give you the floor and see if there's any questions you need to ask.
Yeah, so he has five sheds on the property.
Oh.
And he's worried about the aesthetic of a barn being a little closer to his to the back of the addition.
Absolutely.
And does he work out of his house? Is that it?
No, he goes off-site to do his construction projects.
But, I mean, that's for his job, that barn.
Storing equipment and so forth.
Yep.
Obviously, you want to put a driveway. I'm not in favor of, I think those are weak arguments to keep it in, to put this in a no disturb, no build area when you have so many other areas to locate it. And to say, well, it won't look so good because it'll be closer to the new addition. I don't think that's a strong argument. And I think we give these out like candy, and I'm not willing to do that.
Well, I would appreciate if you would see the site before you take an opinion, because I think you'll see there's good reason where it's located.
All right.
Yeah.
Is that it, Mike?
That's it.
Okay. Chelsea?
Sure, yeah. I mean, I know we're all going to probably end up going on a site visit to the site to actually get a feel for the yard, but like, if shed A is going to be moved, why couldn't the barn go in that spot, you know, cut out some of that gravel driveway, pull it at least completely out of the no disturb, if not entirely out of the 50-foot no build? Because to put an entire barn within the no build zone, that's going to be a hard sell for me.
Yeah,
it's a barn
only partially,
and a driveway.
Yeah, it's only partially. Here's the no build line through here. It's partially in there. And again,
it's mostly in there.
We cited that so that we could stay in between these two mature trees. If you're looking at we have to consider this one too.
We'll turn it the other way. So yeah. It's a long way.
We have there's a design to it.
Right.
And we tried to consider that where the door
opened. No, I'm sure there's like a whole lot that I'm not seeing here, but just at first blush, I'm like, wow, that is a large structure in the do not build structures zone. We're gonna have to go do a site visit to really like get an idea for what we're working with. Is just the plan does not look good to me. I'm gonna have to see
it in person. You'll see that, you know, it's all grass. It's already, it's been developed since the 50s.
Right. Oh, that's all I had.
Okay, thanks. Ann?
The barn is not replacing all these sheds. It's keeping all these sheds on the property?
No. This one gets removed, that one gets removed, this one gets removed but replaced with A, and this one gets removed.
Oh, okay. All right. It just seemed odd to have all the sheds in the barn as well. The gravel driveway is coming down grass, right? Is this grass now?
It's all grass, yes.
Okay, so there's nothing, in other words, would that have to be dug up?
Normally you would remove the topsoil and put down some kind of crush material.
Okay, and any plans with the topsoil?
That would be taken off-site.
Okay, all right. Okay.
And that's just so that, you know, when you have your camper, he's got some toys, and if you were to try to maybe move that in the spring without a driveway, you're probably going to sink in. So that's why the driveway is necessary.
Okay. So what's he doing with the camper right now? Is it in his driveway?
It's up here.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Concrete driveway.
So there's gravel driveways for both moving and storing the van, the camper, and access to the barn?
Mm-hmm.
Is that right?
Yep.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Ann.
No, that's okay. I'm trying to figure out where everything is here. Okay. All right. No, I don't have any more questions right now.
Okay.
Thanks. Okay.
Vanessa, any questions?
Just one. I just want to clarify what the black polygon is that's to the left of the barn. It has like that 18. Oh, I think the 18 inches for the tree, but what does the black polygon denote?
Yeah, that's the outline of the mitigation area.
Okay.
Those brick and materials.
Oh, there's a whole pile of brick and materials that are stored against the fence, that clouded area.
That fluffy shape, okay.
Yep.
Gotcha. I couldn't tell if the fluffy shape was the shrubs, because sometimes they're put in as that.
It's overlapping with the big polygon, right. But like this little corner here is.
Right.
Okay.
Another question, is there a drop-off after the wire fence into the brook?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
It drops off. These are 1 foot contours, so 40, no, they're 2 foot, so 44 down to like 37. So
okay.
Good 7 foot drop.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Vanessa, did you get your question answered?
I did, and I agree that I would like to see the site.
Okay. Okay, is there any public comment? Okay, so I guess we need to schedule a site visit. But I think, Bill, I'm sure you're aware that, you know, there's a lot of objection to putting something in the no-build zone. Mm-hmm. So just give that some thought, and we'll get out there and we'll see the whole thing, and then hopefully we can work to something that works for everybody.
Is that flagged, Bill?
Is it flagged?
Yeah.
We'll have a stakeout where it's going to go.
Yeah, but I mean the 35, the 50 on the ground.
We'll do something to mark that for you.
Yeah, please. Yep.
Okay.
All right, Georgia and Bill, could you guys work together to get something?
Yep. Are we still doing things after 5 o'clock or even during the day?
Well, for Chelsea, has the hardest commute, so we try to, you know, as late as possible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
We need daylight.
Weekday 5 p.m. is usually the go-to.
What's
5:30?
5:36.
5:30 would be easier, just because traffic's been wild late with all the students back in town.
Is the commission still entertaining possible weekend morning visits?
Yeah. I mean, I could.
I also throw that out. I know they've done a couple Saturday morning, but I'm not sure how Bill would feel.
Prefer to stay a few more, you know, an hour during the week than to come down on a weekend. But
I feel the same. I think they do too. Okay.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill.
Thanks, Bill.
Thank you. Okay. So if someone can make a motion, we'll continue. Do you think we can pull that off in the next 2 weeks?
I will not be able to make the next meeting, so I do need to continue it to your first meeting in October.
Okay, which is October.
So we got a little flexibility.
We have a three-week gap somewhere, right?
Yeah, that's October 13th.
Okay, someone make a motion to that then?
I'll make a motion that we continue the hearing for 24 Princeton Street to our next scheduled meeting in October, which is October 13th.
Mm-hmm. Second the motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, next up, thanks, Bill.
Thanks.
Is a notice of intent for 7 Chevalier Ave, DEP file number 14-1386. The applicant has requested that we continue to September 22nd meeting. And just one comment before we vote on continuing. The Harbor Master provided some very good comments.
Yeah.
So if you haven't reviewed those, yeah. I would say that we should before our next meeting.
Yeah.
Okay, if someone can make a motion.
Sorry, Peter. I just want to note, and I can note to the commission in email, but I had met with the applicant for 7 Chevalier yesterday with the Harbor Master, 2 days ago, to talk about those comments in depth. And they are continuing because they are going to revise their plan to address those concerns and give some redesign alternative, so that's why they do need to continue out till September.
Okay, and they're going to be ready for the 22nd?
Yeah.
Well, if not, they'll just continue.
Yeah.
Okay, if someone can make the motion, then we'll continue to that.
I make the motion that we continue the hearing for 7 Chevalier Avenue DEP file number 14-1386 to September 22nd.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, thank you. Notice of intent for 365 Maple Street, DEP file number 14-1391. Just one quick comment. Did everyone was there for the site visit yesterday?
Yep.
Yeah.
Everyone's got a good feel for it?
Yeah.
Did you say 365 and I'm reading 367?
Did I say 365?
Yeah.
67.
I should say 367 is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Okay, if someone can make a motion, we'll continue.
I'll make a motion to continue the hearing for 367 Maple Street, DEP file number 14-1391 to our meeting on 9/22.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Okay. Is there any old or new business that we need to be aware of, Georgia?
There is not.
None? Okay, short and sweet tonight. Right. So someone can make a motion to adjourn. We'll get on with our lives.
I'll make a motion to adjourn the meeting.
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, thank you.